Jason Lockenfora of CBS, CBSSports.com, wrote a column today. The headline, it's time for the No Fun League to get out of the pot policing business. We'll talk about that topic in a moment, but Jason joins us. Jason, we were just talking about Devin Hester being released by the Falcons. Devin Hester, a Hall of Famer?
It's interesting. I hadn't thought about it until Fritzy was kind of letting me know you may spring that on me. If you listen to people like Deion Sanders talk about him, and obviously few did the return thing the way Deion did, and I've spent a fair amount of time around Deion and sat there on Sundays watching him as he watched Devin Hester, he can make a pretty compelling case, and it is a big part of the game, right? It was enough of a part of the game, a significant part of the game, that they've continued to kind of change the rules to try to sort of, you know, take certain explosion out of the game or make it harder and harder to do the things that he did and make it easier for these guys to kick the ball into the end zone. You look at what he did in big moments, and obviously the Super Bowl stands out. You know, you might be able to talk me into it. Or, I mean, I think certainly it's a valid discussion point. Certainly he should be in levels of the conversation.
But we haven't had that true returner who's made the Hall of Fame, correct?
No, and unfortunately the process in most of these sports kind of seems to be like, oh, well, we've never done it, so we won't do it. It seems like it's very staid. It's very difficult to get people to think a little more differently or outside the box or whatever cliche you want to apply. You know what I mean? You look at how few catchers get into the Hall of Fame. You look at how certain positions in other sports are kind of devalued. But I don't know. I mean, to me, it's like if you were that much better than everybody else, if you did something and something of note, not just face a lefty in the sixth inning. You know, if you were a part of the game, if you did something that was a part of the fabric of the game, and you did it so much better than other people for a sustained period of time, which you could make the case for Devin Hester, I think you could check all those boxes to this point, then again, I think it's someone they should be talking about in that room. Do they discard it after 5 minutes, or does it become one of their epic five-hour discussions? That I don't know. I'm not in that room. But I would hope that somebody would bring it up for discussion.
I'll tell Peter King to bring it up.
There you go. He wields much bigger bully pulpit than I do on these things, Dan.
The marijuana topic.
Oh boy!
No fun league. Wait, what do you?
I don't write the headlines.
Oh, okay.
Although I don't disagree with that headline.
Okay,
I'm not editorializing one way or the other when I make that statement. I'm just saying I don't write the headline. Just
okay,
that's reality.
So the headline was no fun league to get out of the pot policing business. But you are writing about why is the NFL all in on this and testing for marijuana? Well, I'll let you sum up your column here for the audience.
I mean, basically, my thought on this, and this isn't a new sentiment of mine, it's just as we got through the weekend and it was just this sort of litany of what was Alden Smith holding a joint or not, and how many times was Le'Veon Bell late or, you know, missed the guy showing up at his house or forgot to tell him he was going to Vegas for vacation. Like, I just feel like we're so far down the minutia of the pot rabbit hole, and it has such real effects on individuals and their lives, their seasons, their careers. It has effects on the competitive balance of divisions and the whole league. It has the effect of fans going out there and spending money, and this guy's not out there because he may have been late to a test or he had a weird sample. I'm just worn out by it, Dan. I'm just fatigued. Like, I'm over. Like, I'm just waving the white. Like, I can't really do it anymore. Like, it just seems like we're in their bedrooms, we're in their dens, we're in their basements, we're in their living rooms. What is the game? Are less kids smoking pot because the NFL has draconian rules against it? No. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Is the societal tide turning towards studying the value of medicinal marijuana, seeing what effects it can have on the brain cognitively and from a repair and relief standpoint when people suffer significant blows to the head, which NFL players are contractually obligated to doing, and when you can walk down the street in Seattle or, like, just spend any time in Seattle or Denver, and it's like you're in a fraternity party. You go down any given street, and it's like, whoa, I'm back to freshman year, you know, whatever. And I just don't get it. Like, now to me would be the perfect time to quietly extend the carrot to the PA and say, okay, look, if a guy gets arrested, if a guy gets caught with it, if a guy is involved in an alcohol or drug-related incident that becomes a legal matter, then you're in our system, and it's going to be a system of treatment, not shaming and wagging the finger at you. And if not, we're done. We don't need to test 350 college kids at the combine anymore. You know, who's gained? Like, just tell me who's gaining from it. What am I missing?
But can the NFL how do you say it without saying it that you're kind of signing off on marijuana use here?
Do they test for HGH?
No.
Well, they do, but has anyone ever been caught?
Yeah, they do now.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's a way to do it. There's a way to have your cake and eat it, too. Like, I think we all know the dirty little secret. They waited years and years and years to actually get around to having the designing the program on how they test for HGH. And now the sample size are so small and the way it's set up that even the, you know, they're not really trying to catch many people. Certainly you're not going to see anything close to the amount of guys using it reflected in the amount of guys who get caught. Use those same sample sizes for pot. Say we still do it and we may catch an occasional minnow, but we're not going to cast such a wide net that we're going to continue to drag stars. You know, I mean, there's people losing seas. Like, I just don't get it. You know what I mean? Like, look, if you're what's his face, Sam Hurd. You know what I mean? Throw him in jail and never let him play again. If you're distributing,
Sam,
if you're involved in promoting narcotics, but if you're sitting in your room at home having a joint, and especially if some of these guys are doing it in places where it's legal, and you can go down the street and buy it medicinally or whatever, why doesn't the NFL spend more energy studying the positive factors of it rather than throwing the book at somebody who gets caught with a joint in their pocket?
Yeah, I think that we're on the same page. I just wonder if the punishment fits the crime here. And we love to do this, where somebody will go, wait, Tom Brady got 4 games for this, or this guy, you know, Josh Gordon's got to sit out an entire season. I understand all of that. I just think that the NFL puts himself in a pretty delicate position of, you know, they could back off this quietly. I was told 3 years ago they were going to do that. They weren't going to go after marijuana testing as hard as they had in the previous, years.
And if you recall, as part of this global settlement to get HGH testing, in so much as nominal HGH testing is done, they did lower the thresholds, right? It used to be a couple years ago that the thresholds for testing positive in the NFL were higher than air traffic controllers, higher than WADA, higher than Olympic standards. So they've come down on what it takes to register a failed test.
Mm-hmm.
But why are we testing 300 kids at the comp? Like, do you think it's deterring? I mean, and again, if there is some benefit from it at a time when brain trauma is such a hot topic, and we know that the league needs to sort of mind their P's and Q's when it comes to this. And you've got more and more players coming out publicly explaining why they do it. There's being legitimate medical studies being done at various hospitals about it. I just think now would be the perfect time to kind of quietly, truly back off and come up with a system where you're kind of still doing it, but it's not meant to get everybody, round up as many guys as possible before they get in the league. Because it's not a deterrent. You don't think, how many guys in the NBA you think are smoking pot?
There are probably a few.
Yeah, right? When's the last time a guy missed a quarter of a season or entire season in the NBA because of failed or diluted or missed drug tests? It just doesn't happen because they're smart enough to understand that the players are the product. And, you know, again, if you're involved in a crime, that's one thing. If we're talking about petty misdemeanors or what happens in your living room, come on, man.
Is the NFL hypocritical in selling of alcohol?
Well, I mean, I would.
I mean, I don't know how deeply we get into this, but you know, if we're making millions and millions of dollars off alcohol, but we're going to crack down on these kids who are using marijuana.
Right, and someone would make the case in the medical community that alcohol will have much more negative effects over time on you than marijuana. And I'm not a pot guy. I'm not a high times guy. Like, I don't know the difference between any of these. Like, it's not my thing at all. It's not my bag. I've never been into that culture. But you can't go a week in this league without something of note happening that's tied to this drug. And you're not going to stop them from using it. And they're making a more and more potent case as to why they are using it. And it's being backed up by science. And it may help their brains a little bit. And it's way safer than another Toradol shot, right, to just get them through the show. Like, I'm just very confused, Dan. This is probably the fifth one of these I've done this morning. I throw it out there to everybody I talk to. What am I missing? Like, who's benefiting? Has it helped Martavis Bryant? Has it helped Josh Gordon? You know what I mean? Has it helped any, like, who's it helped?
But I think the key is how this is all presented. who it's presented to and how it's presented. I think that's what the NFL probably wrestles with here. And you're right. Do I think the NBA, do I think Adam Silver wants to catch any of his players, star players, using marijuana? No. And I think they've quietly gone about trying not to, whereas the NFL, they seem to be all in on it.
Yeah, and you know, again, at a time where we just saw some pretty neat stuff between the NFL and the NFLPA yesterday in terms of, you know, finally establishing a more set protocol for teams that violate the concussion protocol themselves and send guys back into games when they shouldn't, et cetera. So clearly they can collaborate, and they have gotten together. This is one where I would hope that maybe quietly through horse trading, they work this out and they get out of the pot game, and in exchange for that, you know, whatever, the players agree to work with the team on, with the league on moving a team to London, any of the pie in the sky things that the league wants, 18 games, London, what have you. I think there's a meaningful dialogue to be had that involves getting out of testing for pot unless someone does something that becomes a legal matter that now obviously you're going to take action.
Thank you, Jason.
Anytime, brother.
That's Jason Lockenfor, CBS Sports.
The Dan Patrick Show, weekday mornings on Audience.